Good morning. I'm Andrea De Domenico from the University of Catania, and today I'm going to present Ontocomedy Sources, an ontology for describing the primary iconographic sources of La Divina Commedia. To begin with, I'm going to tell you about primary sources in the context of literary works, and after a brief mention of the semantic web modeling languages, I'll present our ontology, along with a clarificatory example. In the case of La Divina Commedia, primary sources are defined as the works of other authors to which Dante Alighieri refers in his text, for example Aristotle or Virgilio. The study of primary sources, which are mainly literary or iconographic, is extremely valuable in the field of humanities, for example to reconstruct the evolution of the author's cultural background. Unfortunately, this knowledge is largely implicit to modern readers. This is especially true in the case of iconographic sources, because they are harder to find and categorize. In fact, this is still an active research topic. We are the first to deal with iconographic sources of La Divina Commedia. Previous studies consider only literary sources of other works of Dante. Our ontology is written in the Web Ontology language, a standard knowledge representation language for the semantic web, useful to extract and process implicit information present in data, permitting to gain a deeper knowledge of the domain. We called our project Ontocomedy Sources. This ontology aims to represent the iconographic and literary sources of Dante Alighieri's Commedia, with particular emphasis on the former ones. For this purpose, we make use of different standard foundational ontologies. In particular, we use the SIDOC conceptual reference model to represent iconographic sources, while to model knowledge concerning literary sources, we made use of the Dublin Core ontology, the semantic publishing and referencing ontologies, and the Open Annotation Core data model. I will now begin to describe the structure of our ontology. Here, classes are represented by oval-shaped diagrams, while arrows represent properties. As illustrated in this slide, the structure of the Commedia is modeled by the classes Verse, Canto, and Cantica. These are subclasses of Line, Chapter, and Book, respectively. Naturally enough, a verse is contained in a canto, and in its turn, a canto is a part of a cantica. This is expressed by the object properties is verse of, is canto of, and in canticum, along with their inverses. The class Fragment occupies a central role in the ontology, as each of its instances refers to a specific textual fragment of La Divina Commedia. Based on the class selector, we can make explicit the exact position of the corresponding fragment in the text. Every fragment has a starting verse and an ending verse. Furthermore, a fragment could even refer to smaller fragments within it. Such knowledge is represented through the properties start verse, end verse, and composed of. To explain the connection between a text fragment and the literary or iconographic source it refers to, we use the class Annotation. Every annotation is written by a specialized scholar, and in our ontology we specify this fact with the property contributor. The association between a fragment and the work cited in it is modeled by the property cites, whose range is the class work. In its turn, such a class is paired with the class author through the property creator and with the class concept via the property subject. The instances of the class work are the literary and iconographic sources we are interested in, while the class concept is used to specify the thematic area of the related work. As illustrated in this slide, the class work is a superclass of both literary work and iconographic work. Besides, literary works contains the class manuscript, while iconographic work is a superclass of the four classes fresco, mosaic, miniature, and panel painting. The properties cite as a literary source and cite as iconographic source are both subproperties of cite. The former has literary work as range, whereas the range of the latter is iconographic work. We also employed some classes from the SIDOC ontology to specify the details of an iconographic work. The ontology provides us with the entities to describe the materials employed in the execution of the mosaics and paintings, along with the used techniques. Since we often have no knowledge concerning the author of a manuscript, we included the class antiquary to designate the antiquarian responsible for the preservation of a given manuscript. In this slide, you can see an example of an iconographic source. The image shows a Byzantine mosaic panel, executed in the year 520 and currently conserved in the Basilica of San Vitale, which depicts Empress Theodora. In this case, the corresponding fragment is from Canto number 9 of the Purgatory. The scholar suggests that, when writing about the Aurora, Dante was inspired by the ornaments in Theodora's crown. As you can see from these two screenshots, our ontology comprises of some deduction rules, permitting to draw simple inferences concerning geographical places in relation to iconographic sources, fragments of the Commedia with their corresponding commentaries, or the seated authors in a given canto. In conclusion, Ontocomedy Sources is an ontology modeling literary and in particular iconographic sources of La Divina Commedia, where we made use of some foundational ontologies to represent primary sources. Our ontology could be easily modified and extended to other classical authors. In the future, we plan to extend the ontology to represent knowledge concerning sculptural art and also epigraphic sources. Thank you for your attention.
Hi, I'm Nicola Rizzo and I'm a student attending the Master in Computer Science at the University of Udine. Today I'm happy to present the paper that my professor Agostino Doviero and I wrote about this puzzle, its complexity and its logic programming modeling. The title of the paper is Thrikozoku and its logic programming modeling. First, we'll talk about the game Aikozoku and its rules. Then, we'll propose its generalization, Thrikozoku, that will prove to be NP-complete. Finally, we'll talk about the encoding of Thrikozoku in Minisync and in answer set programming, and we'll show our experimental results. So let's talk about the game. Aikozoku is a mechanical puzzle created in 2009 by Andrea Mainini. It's made of a blue plastic icosahedron, 12 yellow pegs with the numbers from 1 to 12 written on them, and 20 triangular tiles with from 0 up to 3 black dots on each vertex. The game is set up by placing all the pegs on the vertices of the icosahedron arbitrarily. Now, the goal is to place all the tiles on the faces of the solid in such a way that the number of black dots surrounding each vertex is equal to the number of its peg. It is claimed by the game's maker that every initial configuration of the yellow pegs can be solved. These are the 20 tiles that ship with the game and that must be rotated and placed on the faces of the icosahedron. As you can see, some tiles are repeated. Some tiles have three different numbers of black dots, whereas others might have two or three vertices with the same number of black dots. We can take the first steps in modeling the game by labeling the icosahedron with the letters from A to L, as seen in the figure on the right, and describing its faces as triples of vertices, using operators pi 0, pi 1 and pi 2 to obtain the three vertices of a given face. Similarly, tiles can be expressed as triples of integers by reading the number of black dots in clockwise order. We also use pi 0, pi 1 and pi 2 to get the numbers of black dots of a tile, and we encode the possible clockwise rotations of the tiles with 0, 1 and 2. Since the number of different ways the pegs can be arranged is finite, Aikozoku is a finite game. There are infinite possible variants of the game, such as using as playing field another platonic solid. We introduce the problem we call Thrikozoku that abstracts from the icosahedron and concentrates on having triangular tiles and faces, having as much tiles as there are faces, and having integer non-negative capacities. An instance of Thrikozoku is a triple given by a polyhedron, a capacity map that assigns to each vertex an integer, and a multi-set of tiles, that is, triples of integer weights. We can now model the attempt at a solution of Thrikozoku defined by the rotation of each tile and its assignment to a face of the polyhedron P. In fact, an arrangement of the tiles to the faces is defined as a pair of functions rho and sigma, such that rho defines the rotation 0, 1 or 2 of each tile, and sigma is a bijection of the tiles to the faces. An arrangement is a solution if these constraints are satisfied, that is, if the weights placed near each vertex add up to the capacity specified by function C. I guess these constraints are not easy to read, so we can explain them a little bit in the next slide. Given a vertex V, the constraint on its left-hand side considers each weight that gets placed near V. In fact, for each tile T, its weight at position I gets rotated forwards in a circular rotation by function rho, and then gets placed on a vertex. The subscript of the summation is not really handy, so the constraints can be reformulated as follows. By starting from the vertex V, and we know the faces where V occurs because it's part of the input, and by tracking down the weight that gets placed there using the inverse of sigma. Thrikozoku is interesting computationally since it is NP-complete. To prove this, we reduce partition, one of Karp's 21 NP-complete problems of 1972. Given a set A and a function assigning to each element of A a positive integer weight, split A in two sets such that they weigh the same. We can transform every instance of partition, defined by weights S1 to Sn, into an instance of Thrikozoku by building the bipyramid seen in the figure, made by fusing together two pyramids with n triangular faces. We assign to the two apices of the bipyramid a capacity equal to half the sum of all the weights, and using the following tiles, a solution to this instance of Thrikozoku corresponds to a solution of the original problem and vice versa. We encoded Thrikozoku in Minisync and in answer set programming, and we now present some experimental results of the following models on 100 instances of Aikozoku. First, we tested J-code, that behaves like a backtracking algorithm would, in the sense that it sometimes can be unlucky and explore a big subtree of the search space without finding a solution. This can be improved a lot by using a different search strategy, consisting of a randomized search with restart, and this is very effective because there seems to be many different solutions to each instance. But actually, the solvers that performed the best are those using some sort of learning, that is Chaft and Klingo for the ASP encoding. Now that we have solvers that are quite fast, we can tackle the claim that every instance of Aikozoku can be solved. Each instance is defined by a permutation of the numbers from 1 to 12, but we don't need to solve every permutation. Without loss of generality, we impose vertex A to have a capacity 1. Since the icosahedron can still be rotated on its vertical axis, we impose vertex B to have a capacity less of those of C, D, E, and F. We can exploit one last symmetry of the game that has to do with both the icosahedron and the tile configuration. In fact, we can reflect the icosahedron with the plane that goes through vertices A, B, and L. Another way of seeing this is imagining to play Aikozoku in a mirror. But if each instance corresponds to a mirrored one, and vice versa, does a mirrored solution correspond to a solution of Aikozoku? Is the game we are playing in the mirror still Aikozoku or just a specular version? We need to see what happens if we mirror the whole tile configuration. Actually, the tiles with at least two equal weights stay the same, since they can be rotated into their specular version. The same does not hold for tiles with three different weights, but they all have their mirrored counterpart, so the game played in the mirror is Aikozoku. This lets us cut in half the number of instances to check, leaving us with 4 million instances. We managed to solve them in 16 hours with the ASP model and using common hardware. Okay, so to recap, Thrikozoku is an interesting problem from the point of view of complexity since it is NP-complete. Our solvers work really well on instances of Aikozoku. Those who use learning are the best, but the randomized strategy is interesting and could inspire an actual strategy to solve the puzzle by hand. We also verified the claim that every instance of Aikozoku can be solved. There are still some questions to answer, the most important being the NP-completeness of Thrikozoku if we impose the playing field to be a deltahedron, that is, a polyhedron with equilateral triangles as faces.
Ciao a tutti, sono Viviana Mascardi and I switch to English for presenting this paper that was presented at ICLP and that was co-authored by Domenico Pellegrini, a magistrate from the Tribunal of Genova. The paper is about a logical judge inspired by a real armed robbery case that is known and whose description is available online. The data are already anonymized in the case, and what we did was to implement this kind of logical judge By describing some facts, I hope that most of you can read the Italian here. This judge was implemented for a school of magistracy, la scuola superiore di magistratura, in a course that we gave on May this year. And so our audience was Italian. We presented a prologue to 70 magistrates, which is almost a great achievement for our community, I think. So we, of course, facts are modeled in Italian. We implemented some facts about the person that in the real case is named BC, anonymized, of course, and that we further anonymized because we did not want the magistrate to recognize that case. So we named the person Valjean. We followed Victor Hugo names, and we added some facts about witnesses and about the fact that took place. Then we started to model evidences that are real evidences, at least as far as the first three evidences. For example, the fact that that person, BC, Valjean in our case, stated Yamunindi, Yamunindi to his partner in crime. And the person who was supposed to be that person, who had an integral helmet for the motor, so he could not be seen, was also born in Reggio Calabria, and actually Yamunindi Yamunindi is a sentence from Reggio Calabria, from Calabria. And this was a real evidence. And we also added some evidences that were not there in the case. And then we explained the problem to our audience, and we showed that depending on the evidences, we could allow our logical judge to state that the person that was supposed to be the criminal was actually the criminal or not. In this case, Valjean is considered to be the responsible of the armed robbery, but only because we added a few evidences, evidence 4 and 5, that were not present in the real case. The real case was mainly based on the fact that one fingerprint was found in a stolen moped that was used by the criminals, and that fingerprint belonged to Valjean, and also that that person said, the criminal said, Yamunindi, Yamunindi. So the real setting is this one without the evidences 4 and 5, and actually with the real evidences it could not be possible to state, okay, Valjean is the criminal, because the fact that a fingerprint was there in some vehicle used for the crime does not mean that that person left the fingerprint that very day of the crime. It might have left it a few days before. And also, well, saying Yamunindi is not a unique identifier for stating this person is that person, of course. So the evidences were not strong enough, and the magistrate had to acquit that person that was supposed to be the criminal, and this is exactly what we were able to model. You are logic programming guys, so you see that our logical judge is a very simple one, but well, it was shown to 70 magistrates whose computer science literacy is really low. I want to show you the chart C, where we asked to all the magistrates, but we collected only 17 answers. We asked them if they were aware that artificial intelligence is not the same as algorithm or machine learning or natural language processing or automated reasoning. And six magistrates out of 17 said that they were not aware of these differences. But in the end, those who answered the survey, but we also had a very strong feeling during the course with all the 70 magistrates, were happy. And they appreciated the fact that some techniques exist. They are they are not confident that these logical judges can substitute human judges, which is very true and what we wanted to convey. You will not be substituted by machines, but they think that they may help. And the feeling raised by logical judges are curiosity, also some interest in seeing concrete results, and only one among the 17 that answered the survey said that he or she was worried about their potential raise. And this ends my short presentation, and I will be here for the live question and answering time. Thank you. Ciao.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Francesco Fabiano, and today I'm going to present you the work that Alessandro Dalpalù and I realized for this conference. So the work we present is going to be about classifying arteries using answer-set programming from data retrieved from CT scans. Let's go through the presentation outline quickly. So first of all, we're going to introduce some notion about CT scan and answer-set programming, along with some motivation of the work. Then we're going to go through the methodology we employed to do such recognition, and then we're going to conclude the presentation. Okay, let us start by providing some motivation for our work. In Italy, in 2018, almost 400,000 new tumors were diagnosed. And the problem is that each one of these tumors is associated with a really low survival rate. Let's take, for example, the pancreas one that is only 8%. And this survival rate is greatly affected by the detection of the tumor. Because if the tumor is detected early enough, then the patient can be operated, increasing drastically its chance of survival. The problem with this type of detection is that it's really hard to perform, and even expert radiologists can miss 10% of the time. The first step of tumor detection is usually done through CT scans. CT scans is a technology that provides representation of the internal tissue of the patients through X-ray absorption. The output of this technology is usually a set of 2D images that, when stuck one upon another, provide a 3D density map of the patient's body. But identifying tumors through CT scan is not that easy, because as you can see here in the left side image, you have a scan where a tumor is present, and the tumor is a slight shadow inside the blue circle that is almost imperceptible. That is why we want to provide tools that help radiologists identify the tumor. But this automation has some challenges. The first one is the acquisition noise, because all the images acquired through a CT scan present a lot of noise that can be confused with a tumor. Another problem is the high variability in the patient's anatomy and the need for an explanation, because we are dealing with radiologists that are expert in their field and want to know why the tumor has been identified in that area. And last but not least is the problem that each tissue is quite similar in this scan, so it's really hard to distinguish them through image recognition and other techniques. Finally, let us introduce ASP, answer set programming, the tool we use to model the CT scan's results. ASP is a declarative language and is widely used in the logic community, especially in combination with Klingo. And it's really suitable for MP problems, such as the one we're going to see. And what it does, it allows for easy encoding of high-level knowledge. So this is really suitable to encode the knowledge of radiologists or ATLAS. And it produces a solution that can be explained. I mean, they're really easy to be transformed into natural language. Okay, now we are ready to introduce the actual contribution of the paper. This paper tried to formalize the initial step in the tumor automatic detection. What we did, we took the CT scans data and we extracted the vessels from there using an elaboration image elaboration. And then we built a logic program using ASP that tried to classify this vessel. And then we associated this vessel with names and we tested the models on real CT scans. So, as already said, the first step was trying to extract the vessels from the CT scans. It has been done using image elaboration. From each extracted data, we tried and combined a set of voxels into arteries. And then, if the arteries were actually connected to the aorta, we classified them as arteries. So, after this procedure, we had a set of voxels for each possible artery. And what we did, we gave this information to an ASP program. This ASP program, this ASP program, tried to label all the main branches of the arteries and some of the sub-branches of these main branches. We did so by using three predicates that encode actually the main arteries, the bifurcation arteries, and the edge relation. You can see here the predicates. We're not going into detail because we don't have enough time. Then, after building the knowledge base, we built the model. This model is comprised of several confidence rules for each artery that gives a score to each possible association of labeled artery. Then we use ASP to optimize this solution. So we took the model that respected most of the confidence rules, and this gave us some results. Once we described every artery of the thoracic portion of a patient through the model, we tried the model actually on a real CT scan. Unfortunately, we only possess one CT scan because the data are sensible and are not really available right now. But the results are promising. As you can see, most of the arteries were correctly classified. Only some of the sub-branches were misclassified. This is due to the error acquisition that from the vessel extraction that we are working to actually optimize. But we're really happy with the results. Now we are waiting for more CT scans to test and verify. And actually we are trying to reach out some radiologists to improve our model. So to conclude what we did in this paper, we presented the initial step of a tumor identification procedure. We did so by formalizing an ASP model that recognizes the main and some bifurcation arteries in the thoracic part of a CT scan. This will help in the procedure because it's a starting point, starting to recognize the anatomy of the patient, and from there we can start and look for anomalies such as tumors. We also tested the model on a real CT scan and we saw that the methodology is viable because the results are promising. For future development, we will try and improve the performance using medical experience or ATLAS or ontologies. We also plan to introduce negative rules, not only positive one, and dependencies between these rules. And finally, we will try to parse the results in natural language so that also the medical expert can use this program. That's all for the presentation. Thank you very much.
Hi, now I will present the chemotherapy treatment scheduling via AnswerSet programming paper written by Carmine Dodaro, Giuseppe Galatà, Marco Maratea, Ivan Porro and myself, Marco Mocchi. The paper deals with a problem concerning the hospital ward. So here the problems are a long waiting list that have an economic impact on society and the degree of patient satisfaction. During the COVID-19 pandemic, these problems became even more problematic, and so with these premises, it's important to try to better manage the resources to reduce the cost and increase patient satisfaction. Our work consisted of proposing a solution to the CTS problem, generating some instances and testing them, and studying and analyze related literature. The CTS problem consists of computing a schedule for patients requiring chemotherapy treatments. This is a complex problem for oncology clinics since it involves multiple resources and aspects, including the availability of nurses, chairs, and drugs. Chemotherapy treatment has a cyclic nature, where the number and the duration of each cycle depend on the different types of cancer and the stage of the disease. For our solution, the input consists of a list of registration, having some information as the drug that the patient needs. We consider at most three drugs for treatment, the priority score of that patient, and the due date if the registration is for his first treatment, or the days he has to wait before the next treatment. To schedule a proper solution, the model must respect some constraints, so the first session treatment must be scheduled before the due date. The patient must always use the same chair during the session, so if a patient needs to receive two drugs during the session, he can't move from a chair to another, but he has to use the same chair during the session. Each nurse can assist at most K patients each time slot, and the ERK is a value set by the clinic, and treatment must be scheduled as soon as possible, prioritizing the patients with higher priority score. The output consists of the calendar of appointment and the information about which nurse and the chair are assigned to every patient. So here we have the first half of our encoding, and in the first row, we generate the assignment using the check and guess methodology. So the solver tries to give an appointment to each patient and then check if it satisfies the other constraint. The other rules take care of the required resources for each patient, and for example, in the last constraint, it checks that every patient uses the same chair if he has to stay for more than one slot of time. In the second half, we have other constraints, and in particular in the last row before the weak constraints, we have a constraint that checks that the amount of drug used is less than the available quantity. To do so, the encoder counts how many times is assigned a particular drug, then it divides the available quantity of the drug for the dose associated with its usage. Then we have the weak constraints, and the first three weak constraints minimize the sum of the day assigned to every patient with priority 1, 2, and 3 in decreasing order. So this is used to assign the patients as soon as possible, and in particular it assigns before the patients with priority 1 and then the others. The last row isn't really necessary, but we have found that it helps to reach a better solution. And what it says is to assign every patient as soon as possible without taking into consideration the priority. To test our solution, we generated some instances with random values. In particular, we considered three different number of patients, 60, 80, and 100. And for each group, we generated 10 instances. We evaluated these instances in two different scenarios, alpha and beta. In scenario alpha, we used the number of drugs that is coherent with the other parameter considered. In our case, 15 chairs and 5 nurses, and the planning length of 14 days. While in the beta scenario, we drop off the amount of drugs available to test out our solution in an imbalanced situation. In the table, we summarize the average number of patients with different priorities in both the scenario. We use these instances to evaluate our solution, and this graph are from scenario alpha with 80 and 100 patients. The first table represents the average usage of drugs for each day. And we can see that we even reach a peak of 100% of usage, and the values are almost always over the 90 score. And here, A, B, and C represent the different drugs that, that each day are used. The last two graphs represent how the patients are scheduled for their first session. The blue bar represents the patients with priority 1, the orange bar with priority 2, and the green with priority 3. We can see that all the patients with priority 1 are scheduled the first day, while the patients with priority 2 are scheduled the next days. And just when the patients with priority 2 are ending, the schedule starts to assign a treatment to the patients with priority 3. To wrap up, we have proposed a solution to the CTS problem using ASP. And given the experimental analysis, ASP is confirmed to be a valuable AI tool for complex scheduling problem. And for future work, we plan to enrich this work by testing our solution with other numbers of patients and studying and propose a solution to the rescheduling problem. Finally, we plan to experimentally confront alternative solutions presented in the literature. Thank you.
Hello and thank you for being here. I am Loris Bozzato from Fondazione Bruno Kessler and I'm here to present the paper Reasoning on Information Tel Semantics with ASP for Constructive AL Bottom, a joint work with Camillo Fiorentini from University of Milan. In this work, we continue our study about the connection of constructive semantics for description logics with answer set programming by dealing with negative information in AL Bottom. Basically, constructive description logics are reinterpretation of description logics under different constructive semantics. These semantics have been most formally studied to use constructive properties in knowledge representation problems. However, for now, there has been not enough attention on the practical aspect of applying them in reasoning tools and languages. Thus, our overall goal is to develop reasoning tools for constructive description logics. And the approach we are following is to use connection of such semantics to answer set programming. In this work, we continue in this line of research by extending our work to negative information in AL Bottom, and we first provide the definition of a constructive DL ALC bot based on information tel semantics, and then we show how the formal relation between ASP and information tel semantics can be preserved in this logic. In the following, I'll try to provide a brief insight of these two contributions. With respect to the language, we consider the basic definition of ALBottom. The only notable difference is the introduction of generators that are concepts over a fixed set of individual names that are used in a limited form of concept inclusion. This restriction simplifies the presentation of the constructive semantics. The classical semantics for AL Bottom is defined as usual, where, as you can see, we restrict the form of concept inclusions only to generators on the left-hand side. On the base of this, we define our information term semantics for AL Bottom. Intuitively, information terms are syntactical objects that justify the classical truth of a formula, and we consider a reversibility relation that defines the truth of a formula justified by a given information term. Here is the formal definition of an information term semantics for AL Bottom. For example, you can see that an information term for an existential formula provides a witness element that verifies the existential and then inductively provides an information term for the subformula. In a classical model, this is realized if there is actually the relation with the element D and the subformula is realized. Note that we do not associate a constructive reading to negative formulas. These are considered as constraints similar to atomic formulas, and we only require that this hold in the models we consider. On the basis of this semantics, we study the connection of this semantics with answer set semantics, for example, with the task of computing all of the information terms of an input knowledge base. Intuitively, we first need to define what is an answer set in the context of AL Bottom. For this, we define LP interpretation for AL Bottom, similarly to interpretation in logic programming. In order to deal with negative information, we introduce a notion of reduct. Basically, the reduct operation on a formula substitutes to true and false atoms the negative subformulas on the base of their validity in an LP interpretation. Then, an answer set of ILBOT formulas is defined as a minimal model of the reduct of its subformulas. From the side of information terms, we can define a similar notion. We consider pieces of information that are formulas paired with one of their information terms. We can then consider answers of pieces of information that are set of atomic formulas that represent the information content needed to justify the truth of a piece of information. In fact, we can prove that a formula is realized in a model if the model verifies these sets of formulas. From this, we can prove one direction of our main result. If I is an answer set for formula K, then there exists an information term such that I is a minimal model for this piece of information. To show the other direction, we have to separate the positive information in answers from the negative constraints. We then define an answer set for a piece of information if its positive answers meet the negative constraints. By defining a notion of minimal piece of information, we obtain the other direction of our main result. Given a minimal piece of information, then its set of positive answers is an answer set for the formula K. Finally, we can prove that an interpretation is an answer set for a formula K if and only if it corresponds to an answer set of a minimal piece of information for K. So to conclude, in this work we presented a constructive semantics for RealBot, and we extended our study of relation of this semantics with answer set semantics in presence of negative information. As future direction, we want to use these results for the ASP-based generation of information terms for ELBottom, possibly by extending the data log encoding and implementation we previously proposed. Our goal is also to extend this study to more expressive description logic and apply these results to other reasoning tasks as the transformation of information terms. So that's it from my side. Thank you for your attention.